From the Bill Frelick Athletic Center at Yuhas-McGinley Stadium at Penn Hills High School, this is the Coach's Corner. Along with the head coach of the Penn Hills Indians, Neil Gordon, I'm Bill Novari. Neil, we could talk all we want about last week's victory at Plum, but the big word this week, obviously the big matchup with Woodland Hills. How's the team looking health-wise going into this week and preparation-wise? And it seems like every year it comes down to Penn Hills and Woodland Hills for the conference.
Yeah, if you would have asked me in August, I would have told you that this is the year that it probably won't come down to being that matchup. But the kids have progressed very, very well, and they seem to be getting better every week. We've remained relatively healthy, knock on wood. And, yeah, you're right. Again, it's the big matchup for one of the top seeds for the conference championship, a chance for us to have beaten Woodland Hills in an unprecedented four straight years. So, yeah, it's the big game, and a great way to go into the playoffs.
Defensively, the Indians have played well all season. You have to be proud of the kids, the way they've been played. Obviously, you need another big effort from them Friday night against Woodland Hills. What is the key matchup, the Indian defense against the Woodland Hills offense?
I think the matchup has to be that we can't let them get big chunks. You know, 65-yard runs by Farish and Griffin, or a 70-yard pass to Gronkowski, or a punt return or a kickoff return. We need to make them work for everything they're going to get. For us to sit down and say that we're going to shut them down is preposterous. That's not going to happen. They're just too talented of a team and too well-balanced of a team. But if we make them work real hard for everything and give them 3-4 at a clip and make them earn first down by first down to, and have a perfect 10, 12, 15-play drive down the field, that's a better scenario for us. Hopefully they'll throw in a hold there somewhere or jump off sides or put the ball on the deck or throw an interception or something like that. So I just think that the cheap big ones are of what have destroyed their opponents this year. And if we're going to be other than another victim, we're going to have to stop that from happening.
Admittedly, the big question mark coming into the season was the Indian offense. You struggled early, although it seems like the offense just seemed to get better every week, especially with the play of your young quarterback, Tommy Fulton. This week, is more of the game going to rest on the shoulders of Tommy Fulton, or is it going to be on the kids like Aaron Williams, the running backs? I mean, where in the offensive scheme are you looking to put the emphasis?
Fulton. If he loses, it's his fault if we lose. No, Tommy, well, certainly Tommy's going to, you know, drive the boat, you know, and see what happens. He's got a cast of characters that he needs to take advantage of, Aaron certainly being one, and Darby and Blakeman and Sipe at the fullback spot, and our wideouts, Carlos and Carter and DJ and Andre Freeman, and, you know, the play of Eric Taylor and Joe Rash at tight end, and, you know, the offensive line goes without saying. But Tommy has been the pleasant surprise that has made us average close to 40 points a game in the last three or four times out. So a team averaging 40 points a game versus a team that is coming off 4.5 straight shutouts is one heck of a, at least media anyway, showcase. And Fulton is running the show. Albeit that he's a sophomore and still a puppy, he's still running the show.
For the past couple of years, I've been a big critic of getting field turf or some artificial surface here at Yuhas-McGinley Stadium. We're still with the grass, one of the few teams. However, with the possibility of rain showers tomorrow night and the field getting a little bit sloppy and Woodland Hills speed, is it now that Yuhas-McGinley being a natural surface almost turning into a home field advantage for the Indians?
I don't think so. We're pretty fast ourselves. If we were slow and they were fast, you know, then maybe you could say this might be an equalizer. But, you know, we're beating a lot of teams with a lot of quickness and speed. So, and we've been throwing the ball a lot. You know, we have the ability to throw the ball, and Woodland Hills has the ability to shut down our run to make us throw the ball. If it's a real sloppy out there and rainy and so forth, that's going to hinder us. It's going to hinder them in running the ball. It's going to hinder us in throwing the ball. So I don't see a home field advantage whatsoever in this scenario. And even the fact that Woodland Hills is coming here, I don't know how much of a home field advantage it is because we're so close and the games have been toss-ups at either place. So I think Woodland Hills feels right at home here. And they've been mutters all their life. I don't see it playing any role right now. Now, next week, if we tear this field up pretty good tomorrow, next week might be a different situation because that field might be very, very bad. But we'll take them one step at a time here.
Now, if the weather gods put their weather machine in your office tomorrow for safekeeping and you got to tinker with it, what would you do?
I don't want it to rain. As much as everybody listening to that might say you're wrong, I don't want it to rain. I want it to be last year was such a sloppy mess. Who made the most mistakes and who made the mistakes in a critical situation? Who dropped the ball and fumbled the ball and couldn't get a grip on the ball and slipping on coverage and slipping on punts and extra points? And I would just as soon be at a dry field, maybe a little of an advantage to Woodland Hills, but let's see it dry and see what happens.
So take Mother Nature out and let the kids decide the game.
Yeah, that's what I would like to happen tomorrow night.
Now, what does this game mean for the playoffs for the Indians?
Well, we've already clinched home field. I think that the winner of this game would be a very high seed, probably second to Upper St. Clair. And the loser would be looking at maybe a 5 seed or a 6 seed, but home field advantage nonetheless. So other than the seedings, it doesn't really make much difference. We're both home next week, and it's not one of those games we have to sit there and say, oh, geez, if we lose, we're done. You know, if we lose, we're coming back Saturday morning. If we win, we're coming back Saturday morning. So it's a big game for bragging rights, and it's a big game for, I guess, title and so forth, but next week's the big one.
You brought 3 more seniors with you as we're getting close to the end of the year here.
Yeah, Joe Rash, been saving Joe for a while. Number 45, our legitimate Division I player. He's a tight end and he can block, and he's a great blocking tight end. 255, 256 pounds. He's a Big Ten type tight end. But I see his value more on the defensive side of the ball, you know, a 255 or a 260-pound defensive end that can get off the ball quick as a cat. So, you know, they're talking about Gronkowski and the tight ends from Woodland Hills. It might be a little game within a game to see Joe bump on heads with that kid. But Joe's been a 3-year starter for us on both sides of the ball. Joe's one of those kids that we try to figure out how to get off the field. Once in a while to try to save him a little bit. He's got a lot of football ahead of him, I think, and look for number 45 to play a significant role tomorrow night, rain or shine. Second one, Terrell Blakeman, not Teddy the sophomore fullback, but Terrell, who was a fullback that we've moved to defensive end now for maybe the last 3 or 4 weeks, and he's in there quite a bit now. Try to rotate his defensive linemen, the ends and tackles, to make sure that they're healthy and well-rested, and try to give them a blow once in a while. And Terrell has really filled an important spot there for us. He's becoming more and more comfortable with the defensive spot, understanding the stunts and when he's got contained and things like that. And the more comfortable he gets, the better off this team's going to be. So Terrell is now maybe 6 weeks ago, not an impact-type player for us, but now he is, and just in time. And the third one, Isaiah Wilkerson, he's a defensive lineman. Everybody calls him Big Breakfast. I've been calling him Big Breakfast, and when I was coming on, I said, what is his name? I forget his name. But personality to the max, just a great kid. Is on the scout team's offense and defense all the time, and he works like a dog. And he's played some defensive tackle in the games, and not just mop-up duty at the end, but he's been in there when it was significant, and he's done a great job for us. And when we sat there and said that the offense and defensive line, the biggest problem was depth, both these kids, Isaiah and Terrell, have alleviated that little bit of a headache for us. We're not afraid to throw Big Breakfast in there anymore, and certainly not afraid to throw Terrell in there. So as time goes on here, as we start getting into this last week and into the playoffs, all three of these kids now are going to play significant roles.
I've been looking for the interview with Isaiah Wilkerson. As you said, the personality. You walk into the locker room, he always smiles, and he keeps telling me, I'm ready, Mr. Navari. I know my questions. I'm ready. So I got to throw some different questions at him tonight to catch him off guard. But I know he's been excited about this.
Yeah, Breakfast, he's a good kid. You know, you want to come into the locker room and see Breakfast there. And I enjoy seeing him there. I try to figure out something to scream at him for once in a while just to, you know, keep myself in shape. But, you know, Breakfast is a joy to have around. He really is. Kids love him.
And this has really been a great group of kids, from seniors, juniors, sophomores. This is a lot of fun. I think I've the most I've had in 13 years with these kids.
Yeah, I think so too, Bill. And I think our 6-1 record is indicative of the type of kids we have. You know, they're screwing around. They're going to be kids, but when it's time to straighten up a little bit and listen to the coach or listen to the teacher or listen to mom and dad, they do it. So, a big question as to the development of this team is going to depend on what kind of kids we had and were they coachable. And we're 6-1, and I'm not sure we should be 6-1, considering, Bethel, North Hills, Gateway, and some of those teams we've played. But I think a lot has to do with their physical abilities, but I think a lot has to do with their mental capabilities and their character and discipline. And these three kids tonight are pretty good examples of that.
I'm sure keeps coaching fun. Best of luck in the conference championship game tomorrow night against Woodland Hills. But stay healthy with the games that count. Start next week right here at Yuhas-McGinley. And look forward to talking to you with next week.
Good. Thank you, Billy.
Coming up next, our Seniors of the Week as the Coach's Corner continues here on the MSA Sports Network. Our Seniors of the Week, Mary Lemieux, Terrell Blakeman, and Joe Rash of the 2006 Penn Hills Indians. Let's start with you, my buddy. Isaiah Wilkerson.
Yes, sir.
They call you the Big Breakfast. Why do they call you the Big Breakfast?
Because last year and this year, during Hell Week, I used to be the first one to get some breakfast.
What is your favorite part of the Big Breakfast?
Pancakes and sausage. Nice little syrup. Yeah.
Anything else?
No, not nothing else.
You've been looking forward to this all season. I'm glad to have you on. The coach was talking about the way you are in the locker room, the way everyone's seen it. I go walking in there. We had the break before you guys come out, and all the players are like all excited because the Big Breakfast is coming on. Do you want to talk about how does that make you feel whenever you're in that locker room and everybody kind of like rallies around you a little bit?
We're just one big family. You know what I'm saying? Everyone likes everyone to succeed around here, so we just take that all to heart. We all get proud from one another, so we just make sure that everyone succeeds and gets on top, and that's what we got to do. Okay. Sort of like some support team. That's
and you kind of want to go into the business a little bit, right?
Yeah, I want to be going to internship for the Channel 11 News team, so hopefully I'll take your job.
Okay, well, you know what? We've agreed that you can do it right here. Go ahead. You can interview the other two guys. Go right ahead.
All right. We're here on the breakfast show, and I have here Terrell Blakeman. So, Terrell, you have a younger brother, Teddy. Do you two ever rival out whenever you're at home?
All the time.
All the time. What do you think about the game that's going to come up? How do you think we're going to do?
Man, I hope my man A-Wall just break for $1.50. My man Hollywood, dog. I hope my man do his thing.
At the end of the game, what do you think the score is going to be?
I don't know. I hope a whole lot to nothing, basically.
I also have here Joe Rash, number 45, a.k.a. King Joffy, a.k.a. the Kid. So, Joe, going to this game, how do you think we're going to do?
Victory. Don't matter how we do. Just know we're going to get it done.
Right. So, Joe, you like defense more offense, am I right?
Yeah, I'm not really an offensive guy, but Coach Gordon put me where he need me, so I got to help the team.
So, how many tackles and sacks are you going to get this game?
This game, a rough number of sacks. I'll go with a nice low figure of 3. Tackles, looking for double figures.
Good, good. So, whenever we come out, what's going through your head whenever we come out the tunnel? What are you thinking about the most?
Victory. That's it.
That's all we have is victory here, folks. Want to take over?
Oh, no, you're doing great. I think I might have to retire this year. But, no, that's outstanding. I mean, you guys, obviously, he kind of hit everything with you guys. Terrell, one thing was talking about, you see Teddy out there a lot. Yeah. He gets a lot of the PA announcements. You got to do it when you make a tackle, so you don't get as much. But, still, you guys root each other on a little bit, right?
Yeah, it's been like that since we've been playing in Wilkesbury. He do something, I'm not in. He get his props, I do something. I better get my props. I know that. But it's been like that. That's one thing my dad always taught us. Support your brother, even though he's doing better than you. I'm doing better than him.
Dad influenced you guys a lot?
Dad and my mom. If my mom wasn't here, I don't know what I would be doing right now, though. Yeah.
That's great, Joe. I know your dad's been a big influence on you. He's up here at practice all the time. Has he been the biggest influence on your career?
Yeah, I'll have to say so. My dad, along with my mom, my oldest brother, too. My family's a tight-knit group. So, yeah, they play a big role in what I do.
Okay, well, best of luck to you guys. And who'd you like better? Well, best of luck to you guys against Woodland Hills. Hopefully you guys can bring home a conference championship, and best of luck to you guys in the playoffs. Our seniors of the week, Isaiah Wilkerson, Terrell Blakeman, and Joe Rash are the 2006 Penn Hills Indians. Coming up next, it's the Big East Conference Championship, the Penn Hills Indians and the Woodland Hills Wolverines, and it's coming your way next here on the MSA Sports Network. From Yuhas-McGinley Stadium in Soggy, Penn Hills, Pennsylvania, tonight it's the Big East Conference Championship between the Woodland Hills Wolverines and the hosts, Penn Hills Indians. A very pleasant good evening to you as best we can. I'm Bill Navari. Great to have you along here tonight. The Indians tonight, 6-1 overall, 4-0 in the conference, take on the Wolverines from Woodland Hills, 7-1 overall, 4-0 in the conference. The Mount Lebanon Blue Devils knocked off the Woodland Hills Wolverines in week one by a score of 23-14. Since then, the Woodland Hills Wolverines have pitched 5 shutouts in the next 7 games, given up 28 points since then. That's a 4 point per average game, point per game average in their victories. They've won at Baldwin, North Allegheny, Central Catholic, and in the conference, Fox Chapel, Gateway, Plum, Kiski. Now tonight they take on the Indians. Indians an opening week win against Bethel Park. The following week traveled up to North Hills, were shut out 19-0. Since then they've beat McKeesport, Kiski, Fox Chapel, Gateway, and Plum. Both teams undefeated in the conference, and tonight's winner will be the top seed out of the Big East.
Hey, how are you doing?
Captains at midfield for both teams. The captains for the Woodland Hills Wolverines, you have Vondre Griffin, Luke Trowell, Rob Gronkowski, and Greg McClellan. For the Indians, you have Joe Rash, Carlos Scott, Andre Freeman, and Aaron Williams. Big game tonight, no matter if these teams reach 0-9, this would be a huge game between them. Biggest matchup of the year between the two teams. And they look forward to this. Can't remember the last time Penn Hills and Woodland Hills played here at Yuhas-McGinley, and it wasn't in a downpour. Of course, once again tonight, it is raining. Although the field in much better condition than it was last year at this time when these teams met here in week 9. And the Mudfest decided on a late field goal, an Indian victory, which gave them the conference title last year. And it looks like the Indians have won the toss. And they will elect to receive and get the ball first to start things off here at Yuhas-McGinley. The Indians in the gold helmets, red jerseys, gold pants. The Woodland Hills Wolverines, the teal helmets with the black stripes, the white jerseys, and the black pants. Playoffs will begin this coming Friday night. Both Penn Hills and Woodland Hills will be at home regardless of what happens here tonight. Winner of this game will most likely be a number 2 seed in the playoffs, either Penn Hills or Woodland Hills. And then you have to start figuring things for whoever does not win tonight. I think Woodland Hills lost. They should drop no lower than 4. The Indians may stay at number 4, possibly number 5. But I think you'll see the winner at number 2, the loser at number 4. But both teams will be at home Friday night to start round 1 of the playoffs.
I never did not have a pen or pencil.
Teeing it up for the Woodland Hills Wolverines. Number 90, Mike Belcito, the senior, place kicker and the punter. You see back for the Indians, Carlos Scott, flanked by Chris Darby to his left. And on the near side is DJ Wild. Squib kick. It'll be taken by Wild at the 15-yard line. Tries to find some room and does across the 20. Will go down at the 25-yard line. So slick ball tonight will be in order. So the key to tonight's game, which team puts it on the carpet the least? Maybe a big factor. Tommy Fulton under center, I formation behind. Fulton will give it off to Aaron Williams. Will bust his way ahead for a pickup of five on the play. And it'll be second down and five for the Indians. Very special happy birthday tonight for Matt Strauss, number 21. All the parents are here in the press box. He's home having a wild party. Clock running, approaching 11 and a half to go here in the opening period. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills. Tommy Fulton, the sophomore quarterback. Sipe is in front of Williams, and it'll be Williams again. Williams, left side, will have a first down for the Indians across the 40, out to the 42-yard line. A pickup of 12 on the play, and the Indians get a fresh set of downs. Going to be interesting to see what would happen if the Indians do get on the board here early. Again, the Woodland Hills Wolverines shutouts five of their last six and four straight. Last team to score on the Wolverines was Central Catholic in their victory at the Wolverina. Wide receiver screen, are they calling it a fumble or an incomplete pass? They're going to call it a fumble. They called it a lateral over to Carlos Scott. Carlos Scott will lose 3 yards on the play. And the Woodland Hills Wolverines get the first break of the game at the 28-yard line. Wolverines led by their quarterback, Vondre Griffin. He runs the show. He'll keep it on the ground, and the Woodland Hills Wolverines will dive ahead up for about 3 yards. Marcel Farish with the carry. And they'll move down to the 25-yard line. So the officials ruled that the wide receiver screen was, in fact, a lateral and not a pass. Therefore, Carlos Scott with be credited for a 3-yard loss on a run. Griffin under center, double tight eye formation. Single man to the near side is Johnson. Griffin will keep it on the ground. Farish again. Farish will fight his way ahead. Be short of the first down, just shy of the 20-yard line. I'll give him a pickup of five on the play, and we'll call it third down and two. Aaron Williams making the tackle.
Short gain on the play, third down.
And it's a long two for the Wolverines. Clock running, 9:45 to go here. Opening period, we're scoreless. Penn Hills and Woodland Hills, the Big East Conference Championship. And the WPIAL Quad A bracket. Farish again, looks to the right side. The Indians are there, they'll close quickly. He'll be short of the first down. Give him a pickup of one on the play. It'll be fourth and a yard for the Wolverines, and no doubt they'll go for it. So it'll be a long one on the play, closer to 2 yards. Still call it fourth and a yard. Woodland Hills drive set up by the Indian fumble.
Marshmallow or two,
Griffin will keep it himself. We'll look, and he'll have the first down. Get down to the 17-yard line. He'll pick a needed one, got two, and that's a first down for the Wolverines. And Joe Rash coming up to make the tackle for the Indians. Patterson will split to the right. Farish deep. Yezovich was in the slot, and it'll be Farish. He'll get across to 15, fights his way ahead, and the Indians will bring him down at the 13-yard line. Pickup of four, and it'll be second down. Woodland Hills Wolverines is happy to grind it out, and why not? Actually, Woodland Hills getting out of the sloppy part of the field and into the more grassy part, down in the red zone here to our left. Farish has a hole. Flag will come in. This will come back. Farish will go down at the 10-yard line.
Griffin, hands off to Farish.
Flags back at the 13-yard line. That should be a holding call against the Woodland Hills Wolverines, and it is. Little Mark just went back 10 yards, and it'll be second down and long. So the play got marked off from the line of scrimmage. That'll be second down at about 16.
Second down and 13.
Some movement on the line, nothing called. Farish will get nothing there. Coming up, DJ Wilds to make the tackle.
By number two, DJ Wilds on the tackle.
I don't know if he got any. No gain on the play. And it's going to be third and 16 for the Wolverines.
Third and long.
You see two down territory for the Wolverines. Maybe try to get half and half. Griffin on the option. Rolls to his right, tries to get the pass, get it away, and he does. But Farish went down on his knee, and he'll lose a yard or two on the play. He'll lose two, and it'll be fourth and 18. Griffin went to his right on the option. As he got wrapped up, he dangerously pitched it over to Farish, who did a nice job of holding onto the ball, but as he tried to cut, the knee went down on the 15-yard line. It'll be loss of two on the play. And it's fourth and 18. Griffin, looks like he wants to throw, and he does. Sets up, looking downfield, has a man in the end zone, and the pass incomplete. The Woodland Hills Wolverines will turn it over on downs at the 25-yard line. 5:44 to go, first quarter. We're scoreless. Penn Hills and Woodland Hills on the MSA. Fulton will roll to his right, looks downfield, puts up a duck, and it's caught. No, it's not. Dante Brown did a nice job to come back for the ball, and he's unable to hold on to it, and Fulton's first pass of the night is incomplete. So the Indians start right where they began their opening possession of the game, at the 25-yard line. The Indians, however, picked up 5-12 and then fumbled on the wide receiver screen. It was rolled a lateral. Again, Fulton to throw. Looks like he wants to set up the screen, and he does. Chris Darby Darby gets across the 35, close to the 40-yard line. That's a first down for the Indians, a pickup of 15 on the play for Chris Darby. And the clock will stop for the moment until they set the ball. And the Indians up to the 40-yard line. Rain continuing to fall, clock continuing to run. Fulton fumbles it and he falls on it. The scrum comes in, and I think the officials are going to say, yes, he did fall on it. And the Indians are in the muddiest part of the field right now. And it'll be a loss of four on the play for Fulton. Actually, he kind of moved out of that muddy part back to where there's a little bit more grass. So if the Indians can get up to about the 45-yard line, they'll be out of the slickest part of the field. Twins to the near side. Lone receiver up top. That's where Fulton's looking. Throwing down the sideline. Has Brandon Carter. And who comes up with it? Looks like the Woodland Hills Wolverines do. Yes, they do at the 35-yard line. Coming up with the interception, the Woodland Hills Wolverines, Blaine Jefferson. Second turnover of the game for the Indians. And the Woodland Hills Wolverines will start this time in their own territory back at the 36-yard line. So Fulton had twins to the right, looked left, went that way towards Carter. And Woodland Hills had the position on it, and it came up with the turnover once again. Two possessions for the Indians, two turnovers. Farish looking to come to the near side, and he'll be dropped for a loss. Aaron Williams came through the line, grabbed him by the ankles, and he'll lose a yard on the play, does Marcel Farish. And this one turning into a real defensive battle. And it's still early. Clock running at 4:15 to go here in the opening period. Again, we're scoreless. So it's going to be minus 2 yards on the play. Farish again. Looks like he was stopped at the 35. Dan Mason come in, tackled him from behind, drove him up to the 37. It'll be a pickup of 3 on the play for Farish. And it'll be third down and 9 for the Wolverines. Lance Patterson, their wide receiver, coming in to join the play. And that's Yezovich in front of Farish. And there's an equipment problem on the Indians, so the official stopped the clock while they set the chin strap. All they do, the Indians get to look over the offense and see what's going on here. Still a good crowd on hand tonight, but I'm sure the rain dampened what could have been a much larger crowd. And there's a timeout on the field. 3:29 to go, first period. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Please report to the press box. Thank you. The Wolverines on a 3rd and 9. And they're going to go to the end around? No. Griffin's going to fake it. Holds the ball on his hip dangerously. Tries to find a block. Gets maybe a yard on the play. Andre Freeman coming up to make the tackle. And it looks like the Woodland Hills Wolverines will bring in the punting crew. Mike Belcito does the punting for the Wolverines. Back deep is Carlos Scott at his own 30-yard line in the slickest part of the field. Scott would hope to get a nice return, at least, like I said, out to about the 45-yard line or better, as it's really slick between the 30s. But about 40 to 40 isn't too bad. Snap, high! And here come the Indians, and Belcito goes down at the 20-yard line. 19-yard loss on the play. Officially, Woodland Hills will turn the ball over on downs at the 20-yard line. So the Indians catch a break as they fumbled and intercepted, throwing an interception. And now this time, the high snap gives the Indians the ball at the 20-yard line. And the field condition at that part of this field is wonderful. Aaron Williams, tough couple of yards. He'll get down to mark him at the 19-yard line. A gain of one on the play for Aaron Williams. And it'll be second down and nine. I don't think it's going to be a good night tonight for the kickers. Of course, the one and only Deuce in the press box here tonight. Aaron Williams moves to the slot. Chris Darby behind Fulton. It'll be Darby. Darby will fight his way ahead. Breaks two tackles, three tackles finally. Is brought down for a loss of a yard. Heck of a running effort for Chris Darby, just to be credited for a loss of one. And it'll be third down and 10. I mean, that was a nice effort by Darby. He's not real big to begin with, but to bust out of three tackles, finally tacklers four and five able to stuff him at the 20. I formation, sight back in will be in front of Williams. Fulton's going to throw. Play action, looks underneath, and Carlos Scott drops it. Would have had it about the 25-yard line. Second drop of the night for Carlos, and it'll be fourth down and 10 for the Indians. Indians trying to take advantage of an over-aggressive Woodland Hills defense and try to use the play action to get men in single coverage or open into the flats. And now Fulton tonight, 0 of 3. Aaron Williams will be on the ground, gets a block, gets another block, gets inside the 15. He'll be short of the first down, but he'll turn it over to Woodland Hills at the 13-yard line. Pickup of seven for Aaron Williams. And with 1:08 to go here in quarter number one, the Woodland Hills will have it in a scoreless first period at their own 13 here on the MSA Sports Network. Craig, it's Fulton is 1 for 3. That looks like Yezovich out across the 25. They'll get to the 22-yard line. It's a pickup of 9 on the play for Yezovich. And Justin Stevens is the stat king.
Second down and 1, gain of 9 on the play.
Sorry, I missed my filled in circle there. Yeah, wow. I seem to make more than you do. I formation behind Griffin. I think he might keep it himself, but no, it'll be Yezovich. Yezovich pounds his way ahead. We'll have the first down at the 25-yard line. Needed one, got three, and the Wolverines. Get four more. Clock stops for the moment at 27 seconds. The Wolverines will have to run at least one more play here in the quarter. Two turnovers by the Indians, a fumble and an interception. Woodland Hills unable to do anything with it. A high snap on a punt gave the Indians the ball at the 20-yard line. They were unable to do anything with it. Farish. That was a nice job to pick up five on the play. And that'll do it for quarter number one. After one period of play, we're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. The Woodland Hills Wolverines on the change of quarter, now into the sloppiest part of the field. And the Wolverines jump. It'll cost them the 5 yards that Farish picked up. And it'll be second down and 10. That was big Melvin McClellan, the sophomore, 6'1", 284. It's unfortunate. You only seem to only mention the linemen's names whenever they draw a penalty.
Second down.
Second and 10, Woodland Hills at their own 25-yard line. Griffin, play action, rolls to the near side, looking downfield, throws one up. Andre Freeman is there and almost has it, and there's no flag. Great defense by Andre Freeman. It looks like it could have been an offensive pass interference call. But the official, the play was all in front of the receiver. I'm sure he probably didn't see anything. But still, Freeman broke up the pass. That's why he's one of the top DBs in the state of Pennsylvania in high school. And that's going to bring up a third and 10. Griffin actually fortunate that that pass not intercepted. Griffin on the option, looks, nothing there. The Indians stay at home and Griffin will be dropped for no gain. And now the Woodland Hills Wolverines will bring on the punting unit once again. Mike Belcito, I'm sure, back there is. Hoping for a decent snap this time. Carlos Scott will drop back at about his own 42-yard line. This time the snap is true. Kick is away. Carlos Scott will watch it come down, and he'll get it at the 48-yard line. Goes straight up the field, and we brought down at the 45. 7-yard return for Carlos Scott, and the Indians have it. 11 minutes to go here. First half, we're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network.
Assisting on the tackle, number 44, Dykes. First and 10, Big Red.
So we're keeping it here, and the Indians come quickly out to the line. They don't waste any time, do they? Fulton has twins to the near side. I formation, it'll be Aaron. No, it won't. Tommy Fulton on a play action. Has the pass complete. Sipe up the sideline. They're going to roll him out of bounds after a pickup of 10. We'll have the first down, does Ryan Sipe. I wasn't even sure he caught it at first. And the officials move the sticks with 10:52 to go. Now the Indians kind of move themselves into the sloppiest part of the field again. They're at the 35. Tommy Fulton again, that play action. He sells it so well. Wilds and Scott near side. Carter at the top of your screen. Sipe in front of Williams behind Fulton. Williams. Goes over the pile, feet first. Give him a pickup of 3 on the play.
Tackle on the play by Jefferson.
And Jefferson comes up to make the tackle for the Wolverines.
Tackle, number 65, Lucas.
Williams, 4 carries, 25 yards in the first quarter. Tommy Fulton was 1 of 4. No. 5 for 28 in the first quarter. That's why Justin Stevens is the stat king. Okay, but Tommy Fulton was 1 for 4 and 1 interception. He's now 2 for 5 as the flag comes in. Who flinched? Did the Wolverines jump or did the Indians move? Looks like the Indians moved since they're all looking backwards. Not sure the way it's called. Was it Carlos Scott jumping on the near side? I don't know. So it'll be second down and 12. It'll be second and 13. Aaron Williams holds on to the football. And gets back to the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play. So the Indians now will be looking at a third and 13. The rain still coming down.
Tackle by Jefferson and Simmons. Third down.
Quickly moving game here.
Yes.
Darby comes in motion near side. Here comes Fulton. He dips it off to Carlos Scott, who gets a block and goes down at the 35-yard line. So he'll pick up three on the shuffle pass. And it'll bring up a fourth down and 10. And they're going to bring in Coyle to punt. I think they will. They're going to try to move Woodland Hills as far back as they can. And if this one goes into the end zone, they only get pick up 14 yards on the change of possession. But I think they're looking at Coyle to try to put this in somewhere where the Indians can down it inside the Woodland Hills Wolverine territory. High kick. This one will sail into the end zone. No, fair catch. Called for at the 3-yard line. Holy cow. Oh, my, oh, my. Griffin will probably hear that one. This one clearly headed into the end zone, but Griffin fair caught at the 3-yard line. So the Wolverines will start in the shadow of their own end zone. Holy cow. So now the Indians, one defensive play here from putting the first points of the game on the board. Farish into the pile, gets maybe 2 yards to the five. They're going to give him 3 to 6. Oh, goodness. Merry Christmas.
Farish, the ball carrier, tackled by number 24, Aaron Williams.
Aaron Williams up to make the tackle, but now the Woodland Hills Wolverines have a little bit of breathing room. Ball at about the 5.5-yard line. First man through is Jezovic. And Jezovic will get to about the 10-yard line. 4-yard pickup for Jezovic, and it'll be 3rd down and 3. The Wolverines would be content to just try to grind it a few yards at a time. Certainly not trying to do anything foolish down here deep in their own territory. Ball at the 10-yard line. Only good thing for Woodland Hills is the field is in good condition there. Farish tries to find a lane. The Indians close, and Farish, will he have the first down? He'll be close, but it looks like he's a yard short. Needed 3, got 2, did Marcel Farish. And it'll be 4th and 1 yard for the Wolverines. And the Wolverines look like they're going to keep the offense out there. They try to... Nope, here comes the punting unit. The Wolverines are going to do well to call a timeout here after a long decision. And they do call a timeout. 6:25 to go, first half. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Scott at his own 46-yard line. Another high snap. Del Cito pulls it in, gets a kick up. Carlos Scott at the 46-yard line. Breaks the first tackle and goes down at the 38. 6:14 to go here, first half. The Indians with it at the 38-yard line of Woodland Hills. No points yet. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Fulton again, the Indians in the sloppiest part of the field, and it's just getting sloppier. And Fulton will throw, looks right, and Carlos Scott didn't expect that one at all. Carlos Scott was out blocking. Had he run the hook, he'd have had a first down for the Indians. So with the play, the clock will stop with 6:09 to go here in the half. Second and 10. Carlos Scott will go in motion. They'll fake the reverse. And Aaron Williams will carry Wolverines up to the 35-yard line for a pickup of 3. The Indians will be looking at a 3rd and 7. Indians with 2 turnovers in their first 2 possessions. The Woodland Hills Wolverines, a high snap on a punt, gave the Indians the ball at the 20-yard line. They couldn't do anything with it. They turned the ball over to the Wolverines at the 13-yard line. Indians punted moments ago following Woodland Hills Wolverines punt. They had it at the Woodland Hills at the 3. They punted from the 12. And that's where we are at this moment. 5.5 to go here, second quarter, scoreless. The Big East Conference Championship. Penn Hills and Woodland Hills. Fulton, play action, has a man. Carlos Scott, and the pass is overthrown.
Good pass intended for wide open number 1. Carlos Scott is
incomplete. I don't know if there was a miscommunication on the pattern or Fulton threw it away, but it's going to bring up a 4th down, and the Indians will bring the punting unit on once again. And I think Andre Griffin was told, don't fair catch it at the 3. Although, watch the Indians on the fake punt as well.
Joe Coyle to kick for Penn Hills, number 52, Coyle. Griffin to receive for Wolverine. Timeout, official.
The officials blow the whistle for something. I could bring out the clean ball. Coyle gets the snap, gets the kick away, high. It's going to hit inside the 5. It will go into the end zone. Indians look like they may have had a chance to down it inside there, but nobody closed on the ball, and the Woodland Hills Wolverines will have it at their own 20 with 5-11. Oh, it's a flag back at the 44-yard line. What is it? Somebody hit Coyle? That's going to be a 5-yard running into the kicker. Why not? Take the 5 yards, kick it again. I mean, what could they do? We'll kick it in the end zone and put it at the 20-yard line again? Or were they going to go for it now? It's going to be a 5-yard running into the kicker penalty. So instead of 4th and 7, it'll be 4th and 2. Bring it up to the 30-yard line. If you go for it here and you don't get it, what did you do? You surrendered 10 yards to the Wolverines at the 30 instead of the 20. Or they're going to try to draw the Wolverines off sides and get the cheap first down. Power eye behind Fulton. Again, the Indians in the sloppiest part of the field. Looks like there's room to the right. Fulton fumbles the snap, gets it away, and he'll be sacked back at the 36-yard line. Again, the Indians in the sloppiest part of the field. Might not have been a good idea to do it from that point. So he'll lose 6 on the play, and they'll turn it over on downs. The Wolverines will get it with 5:04 at their own 35. So it's a loss of 5 on the play. Now the Wolverine offense. Back on the field, but now again, they're in the sloppiest part. Griffin will throw. Looks right to swing pass. Farish has a lane. Aaron Williams will come up and make the tackle, but not until Farish gets the first down. They're going to mark him out at the 47-yard line, a pickup of 12. On actually the run, since it was a backwards pass. So officially going into the books as a run, not a pass. Yezovich, big hole. Carries Indians ahead for the first down. Out to the 43-yard line. Pickup of 11. Back-to-back first downs for the Wolverines, and they are in Penn Hills territory again. Clock running, approaching 4:35 to go here in the scoreless first half. Yezovich again holds on to the football. Dives out to the 40-yard line. They're going to give him the 38-yard line. They gave him the slide. So a pickup of 5 on the play for Yezovich. A nice carry. And the Wolverines looking at a second down and 5. Marcel Farish, wrapped up. Dan Mason, pickup of 2 on the play. It'll be 3rd down and 3 for the Wolverines. It's been tough sledding tonight for the Wolverines, Marcel Farish. And the Indians look like they, I don't know, the officials, they're gonna bring out the sticks. Oh, so the stick crew comes on out. And it's the first down. Officials wait to set the sticks. The clock stopped for a moment with 3.5 to go. The Wolverines do get the kickoff to start half number 2.
He's getting fucked. That's all there is.
Farish gets inside the 30, picks up 5. He's second down and 5. It's like the Wolverine offense starting to wear down the Indian defense a little bit. Yezovich, first man through, slips, goes down at the 31. Excuse me, the 26. Griffin's going to throw, pumps, looks, nowhere to go, tries to get a block, doesn't, and it'll be dropped for, I don't know if he got back to the line of scrimmage or not. Looks like they're going to give him the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play. It'll be 3rd and 3, or excuse me, 4th and 3.
No gain on the play, 4th down.
Okay. Clock is stopped. Oh, I guess he went out of bounds. Fourth down for the Wolverines. Wolverines like to run the option at this point. There they go. Nope, Griffin's going to drop and throw. Looks downfield and puts up a duck, and it's intercepted by the Indians. Would have done better to just bat the ball down. The Indians would have had it back at the 26, but now they're going to have it at the 11. But nonetheless, the Indians do have the ball with 1:53 to go. In fact, they're going to mark it at the 10-yard line. I think it would have might have been a design play. Aaron Williams for maybe two.
Williams, the ball carrier.
The Indians probably content to kill the clock here in the half. Go in scoreless. Bolton is doing exactly that. He's letting the clock wind down, looking for the signal from the back judge who holds the play clock. And there goes the hand up. And Fulton runs the play. And Aaron Williams ahead for three on the play out to the 15-yard line. And it'll be third down and five. And the Wolverines with one timeout left. We'll probably use it after this play if the Indians don't get the first down. Fulton, looking to let the clock wind down. It's 20 seconds and running. There goes the signal from the official with 5 seconds remaining. Aaron Williams again runs into a wall of Wolverines. Will pick up three.
Aaron Williams over the right side.
And the official's quick to call a timeout as the Wolverines. It'll be fourth down. The clock stops with 9 seconds left. So they're going to have to run one more play. So we'll take a timeout here. 9 seconds to go here in the half. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Coyle back to punt from his own 5-yard line. Indians need to get a good snap. And they do. Coyle gets the kick away. And it'll bounce, roll inside the 50. Woodland Hills fumbles the ball and falls on it at the 44, but the clock has expired. After one half of play, it's Penn Hills 0, Woodland Hills 0. Second half to decide the Big East Conference Championship, and it's coming your way next here on the MSA Sports Network. Second half action about to begin here at Yuhas-McGinley Stadium. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills, scoreless after one half of play. And the Indians will be kicking off for the first time tonight. Short kickoff, sits there at the 25-yard line. The Wolverines trying to come to the near side. We'll have a lane if they can bust across the 30. Carlos Scott, the one man to beat, and the Wolverines will return it out to the 48-yard line. The play slow to develop, but you can see it from up here, the way the near side of the field just opened up. And the Wolverines will start in great field position in a scoreless game for the Indians in the first half. Aaron Williams 9 carries, 35 yards. He had 9 tackles. Aaron Williams, the leading tackler on the Indians. Tommy Fulton, 3 of 8, 28 yards and an interception. It means a couple of turnovers in the first half, a fumble and an interception. The Wolverines threw an interception late on a fourth down play. Farish hit by Goldston. And they're going to give him no gain on the play. It's Christmas here at Yuhas-McGinley. We'll give him the line of scrimmage. Which is the 49-yard line officially. And it'll be second down and 10. Woodland Hills bobbled the snap, and he'll be sacked back inside the 45. Mason will drop him at the 44-yard line. Griffin bobbled. They're going to give him the 45. Ugh. These officials have been gracious in their spots. And it's third down, and we'll call it 14. So Griffin bobbled to snap, rolled to his left. It looked like it was going to be the first man through Yezovich. But Vondre Griffin tried to roll to his left and was unable to pitch it over to Farish. And Mason came in to finish him off back at the 45-yard line. Third and 14, draw play. Farish tries to find a lane, and the Indians will close. Farish does a nice job to come to the near side. But the Indians stay at home, making the tackle big number 74, Johnny Garrett. And it'll be a 2-yard pickup, and it'll be fourth down for the Wolverines. Mike Belcito back to punt once again. His first attempt, the snap went over his head. And the Indians downed him at the 20-yard line. The Indians were unable to do anything and turn the ball over on downs. Opportunity wasted for the Indians. Another high snap. Belcito gets the kick away. Carlos Scott will let it hit at the 28-yard line and go dead at the 20. 9:42 to go, third quarter. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Fulton will bring the Indians to the line. The lone setback is Chris Darby. We'll toss it to the right. And the Wolverines close quickly. Very aggressive defense to the Woodland Hills Wolverines. Darby, no gain on the play. So tough sledding out there for everybody. Marcel Farish, 13 carries, 39 yards. That is not a Marcel Farish kind of night. Yeah, we mentioned Aaron Williams was 9 for 35. A little better yard per carry average for Aaron Williams. But still not a lot of yardage for two of the leading rushers in the WPIAL. Sipe will be in front of Aaron Williams in the eye. Twins to the near side. That'll be Carlos Scott going in motion. We'll toss. He's going to throw. Looking downfield, has a man, and he puts up a duck. Brandon Carter's there. Catches it at the 48-yard line. Inside the 40. Carries Wolverines down to the 34. Davis. 46 yards on the reception to Brandon Carter. A first down for the Indians. Credit that totally to Brandon Carter. Carlos Scott put the pass up. Kind of a wobbly duck. Carter came back for it, made the catch, and the Indians now have it in the sloppiest part of the field once again at the Woodland Hills Wolverines 34-yard line. Williams up the gut, has a bit of a hole, dives ahead across the 30. They're going to mark him at the 30. Four-yard pickup for Williams. Actually, the way I'm looking at the sticks on the far side of the field, yeah, it is. That's right. Four-yard pickup. Held second down and a short six. Closer to five, but officially still six. Maxwell now split behind Tommy Fulton. Wilds and Scott near side. Brandon Carter at the top of your screen, and Tommy Fulton fumbles the snap once again. How many fumbles that is for Fulton tonight? It's probably, I think, three or four. So I'm going to call it no gain on the play. It'll be third and five. So it'll be second and ten. And no fumble for Fulton. Say that three times fast. Quick pass, and Brandon Carter overthrown a little too quick. He was there, and it'll be third down and 10. I think Fulton a little anxious on the play. It'll wait maybe just another half second. And it was connected with Brandon Carter. Fulton now 74 yards passing on the night, and the rain continues to fall. Fulton straight drop, three steps, looks downfield, and he overthrows Carlos Scott. Fulton hit. It wasn't. Passing complete to bring up a fourth down and 10. I think the Indians will bring on Joe Coyle. See, the wind, the raindrops coming down and going left. Flag on the far side is just hanging there. Probably too wet. Really do anything. Coyle just inside his own 50-yard line. And Vondre Griffin back at his own 10-yard line. Low snap. Coyle does a nice job to get it away. Griffin calls for the fair catch. The ball will die inside the five at the 3-yard line. Coyle doing a nice job. The ball come down and it plugged like a nice high little wedge shot into the green. The Woodland Hills Wolverines will have it at their own 3-yard line with 7:18 to go here in the third quarter. Oh my, that ball, they were expecting a bounce and it just plugged. You have to repair that divot. What a game this has been so far. Almost midway through quarter number three, and we're still scoreless. Two of the most potent offenses in the WPIAL. Scoreless through two and a half. Yezovich. I'll give him the 5-yard line. Every third and eight, and no doubt Woodland Hills wanting to go conservative here. Clock running, approaching 6:40 to go here in the third. Second possession of the half for the Wolverines. Marcel Farish in his own end zone behind Griffin. And Griffin rolls to his right, quarterback keeper all the way. The Indians come up and will squash him for no gain. It was a quarterback keeper all the way. The Indians did a nice job to come up, stay at home, and close the holes quickly. And it'll be no gain on the play for Griffin. It'll be third down and 8. Now old glory begins to wave. Third and 8. Let's see if Griffin wants to throw. No, they'll keep it on the ground. Farish hit in the backfield. Nothing doing there. We'll give him a yard on the play. Farish on the ball. And it'll be fourth and 7, and Belcito will have to kick from his own end zone. Biggest thing for the Indians, if you could see between the 30 and 40-yard line, seated about right where Carlos Scott is standing. You'll see on the kick. Sloppiest part of the field. The Indians, if they can get inside that 30, will have nice, decent field positions. The Indians have moved the ball, but once they got into that slop, that's where it's falling apart for them. Belcito gets the kick away. Carlos Scott at his 35, gets it inside the 30, and will go out of bounds at the 28-yard line. So the Indians may move out of the slop a bit. See what it does with the play calling. Let me see if they mark the ball at about the 28, I believe.
Ladies and gentlemen, here is tonight's...
They're going to mark them at the 27-yard line. So the Indians will have great field position, a short field. They should be slightly out of the slop. I would think they might try to maybe do something to the short side of the field or up the middle, just trying to get into a little bit more of the grass. The ball is on the field, and does Tommy Fulton dive on it? It looks like he did. The ball sat there, and Tommy Fulton wisely and alertly dove on it at the 29-yard line. It'll be a loss of two on the play. That one's going to go against Aaron Williams. And now the Indians move back into the slop.
Second down.
Quick pass, Brandon Carter drops it. Oh my, the Indians have been shooting themselves in the foot all night. Now it's third and a long 12.
Oh, marshmallows.
So the clock stops, 4:15 to go in the third.
How's the non-smoking section right now?
What's that?
The non-smoking section?
Out there? Oh, it's still non-smoking.
So Sipe and Williams will split behind Fulton. And they'll toss to Williams, bobbles the football, tries to find a block, and the Wolverines are there. There'll be no gain on the play. So at this point, I'm sure Coyle will come on and punt once again. And the punting team unit will come on. And Griffin will drop back again inside his own 10-yard line. The muff punt would go good right now. Coyle, low snap, picks it up, gets the kick away, line drive. Griffin lets it go by him and into the end zone wisely. 3:12 to go, third quarter, scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Griffin brings the Wolverines up. And it'll be Farish who loses the football. And the Indians say they have it. And the Wolverines get it. Griffin able to come up with it back at the 16-yard line. The loss of four on the play. That'll be second and 14. So both teams having difficulty holding on to the football. Which this isn't the place where the Wolverines will want to turn it over. Griffin, play action, rolls to the near side. Wide open field, this is going to be a big one for Griffin. Across the 40, the 50, in Penn Hills territory, out of bounds at the 45-yard line. Griffin on the play action. See where they mark it. They're going to give him the 44-yard line, a pickup of 40 on the play. So the Wolverines get their first down. The big carry by Griffin. Griffin bobbles it. Woodland Hills keeps it on the ground. And a pickup of about 5 on the play. That's Larry Walker of the Wolverines, his first carry of the night. And a clean jersey. And Johnny Garrett makes the tackle. 4-yard pickup, 2nd down and 6. Jezovic will have the first down, still on his feet. And he loses the football. And the Indians have it at the 23-yard line. The Indians look like, when I was watching, they fell on it. They're going to call Woodland Hills with the football. And the Wolverines will have it at the 23. Oh, my. The Wolverines get a break. It looked like the Indians clearly fell on the football. But Tim Jessel came out of the pile with it somehow. Jezovic again. The Indians can't seem to stop him. He'll get up to the 21-yard line. Pickup of 2. And it'll be 2nd down and 8. So the Woodland Hills Wolverines with a couple of fumbles in this drive. But they managed to recover them both. And the clock winds down. That'll do it for quarter number 3. Fourth quarter action coming your way next. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. As we start the fourth quarter, the Wolverines have now gone 21 straight quarters without giving up a point.
Is that right?
Jezovic again. Pickup of about 4 on the play. It'll be 3rd down and 4. He's doing a lot of tackling from behind where they're driving the ball carrier forward. So Mike Goosby combined into the pile at 6'4", 240, hitting Jezovic, drove him ahead for about 2 yards. Griffin keeps it himself. Pitches to Parrish. He'll be dropped back at the 20, at the 19-yard line. Parrish will actually lose 2 on the pitch. And it'll be 4th down and 6 for the Wolverines. So obviously a big play here in this game. 4th down and 6 Wolverines from the 19-yard line. Deepest penetration of the night so far on this drive. The Wolverines got down to the 17. And the Wolverines call timeout. 10:35 to go, fourth quarter. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Probably the biggest play of the game thus far. The Wolverines, a fourth and six from the Indian 19-yard line. Griffin, straight drop, looks, throws, downfield towards the end zone, and the pass batted away. Ah, my, was it DJ Wilds? I believe it was, who came up to bat it away. The Wolverines will turn it over on downs at the 19-yard line with 10:28 to go in a scoreless game. Now, the Indians have a long way to go. They've had fumbleitis tonight here in the slop. They certainly don't want to turn it over now. Carlos Scott comes in motion. Aaron Williams will get across the 20 to the 21. Picks up two. And Williams will get a breather. Chris Darby comes in. Thompson and Darby in the backfield. That is Sipe. Darby breaks a tackle, gets across the 25-30. Chris Darby will have a first down for the Indians out close to the 35. Mark him at the 35, 14-yard pickup for Darby and a first down. The Indians now at the 35-yard line, and where are they? Right back into that sloppiest part of the field. It seems like the Indians have spent most of the night right there between the 30 and 40-yard line in this spot of the field, no matter which way they've been going. Indians pick up another first down. They'll be out of that slop. Have a decent field ahead of them. Wolverines coming on the blitz, and Darby is smashed. Excuse me, that was Teddy Blakeman with the carry. So no gain on the play for Blakeman, and it'll be second down and 10. Fulton to throw, and the pass is almost intercepted. Brandon Carter was the intended receiver. And it'll bring up a third down. Fulton looks like, you can see, he just can't get his grip on the football. It doesn't help that they're in this slop. Just that one part of the field between the 30 and 40-yard line, and the Indians seem like they've spent the better part of the night at the 35. Clock stops, 8:40 to go here in the third quarter. Carlos Scott, and Fulton loses the football again. Loss of three on the play. It'll be fourth down for the Indians. Fulton and Wiley just unable to connect quite a bit tonight. And Coyle will come on to kick once again. Clock will continue to run. Griffin back at his own 40-yard line.
Set to kick for Penn Hills, number 52, Joe Coyle.
And the Indians can use a nice boomer from Coyle here. Nice snap, Coyle. Gets the kick away high and short. And it will die at the 43-yard line. 7:55 to go, fourth quarter. Scoreless, Penn Hills, Woodland Hills, the Big East Conference Championship here on the MSA Sports Network. Farish, Sloan set back, and Griffin loses the handle on the snap. And loses it still, and the Wolverines will pick it up. No, they don't. Do the Indians have it this time? No, they don't. The Wolverines will recover it at the 49-yard line. No, they're going to call Griffin down back at the 44.
Thank you.
So they're going to pick up two on the play for Griffin. I don't know. I think it didn't look like Griffin was down. I think the Wolverines should have the ball close to a first down here. Wolverines in a little sloppy patch of field. Fortunate to pick up two on the play. Give that credit to Griffin. Farish, he almost loses the football. And he spins ahead. We'll pick up about three. And we'll call it third and five for the Wolverines. Clock continues to run. 6:45 to go here in the fourth quarter. And Penn Hills and Woodland Hills scoreless. The Wolverines have not given up a point since September 22nd. And now the rain's starting to come this way. Griffin, play action. Does it fool the Indians this time? And Griffin will be sacked. Oh, my, that one. Eric Broward was not fooled, stayed at home. Griffin will be sacked back at the 39-yard line. A loss of 9 on the play, and it'll be fourth down for the Wolverines. And Belcito will have to come on and kick. Another high snap inside the 20. Belcito will try to pick it up and kick it away, and he does it. The Wolverines will pick it up, and somebody else kicks it. Are they allowed to kick it twice? That's two forward kicks. They're going to say it's Indians ball at the 39-yard line. That's like two forward passes. I don't know. The Indians will have it with 5:24 to go at the 49-yard line. The Wolverines look like they kicked it ahead into their own man, which means it should have been down right there. Sipe with a carry. He'll get in Woodland Hills territory to the 48-yard line, a pickup of three. I don't know. Belcito kicked it. It went into his own man. Therefore, it should have been dead at the spot. Woodland Hills picked it up and punted again. Should be Indians ball about the 14-yard line, maybe about the 12. Darby. Ahead for about a yard. That'll be third down and six.
Chris Darby carries the football for the Indians. Short game. Third down, five.
Maybe no
to go to the mid over the field and say, game over. Settle for a 0-0 now. Team is the best
player. Aaron Williams on the counter will lose a yard. And it'll be fourth down for the Indians, and they'll have to bring on the punting unit. Still, I'd like to know what the ruling on that one is. I have a WPIAL official down there on the other end. I wonder if he can comment. So clock running, approaching 3.5 to go. Coyle's going to come back and punt from the slop. Seems to me the Wolverines got a break there. I mean, a big, big break. Coyle gets a snap. Kicks one almost vertically. And out of bounds. The Wolverines will have great field position. Oh, my. I'm sure Joe Coyle would like to have that one back. Had a nice snap, had the time, and he kicks it out of bounds at the 33-yard line. All the Wolverines in the slop. Jezovic, who's been a bull in a china shop all night, out to the 43, a pickup of 5. Clock rolls under 3 minutes to go in a scoreless fourth quarter. Game winds up scoreless. After 4, we go to overtime. Game will not end in a tie. And the Wolverines call timeout. 2:38 to go, fourth quarter. We're scoreless. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. The Wolverines on a 2nd and 5. Farish tries to find a lane. The Indians will close, and he'll have the first down. Looks like a rugby match. Give Farish a pickup of 6 and a first down. Clock continues to run at 2:20. One timeout left for the Wolverines. Clock will stop for the moment while the officials set the sticks. Ball at the Wolverine 48-yard line. High formation behind Griffin, Jezovic, and Farish. Griffin will keep it himself on the option. Looks to the near side. Looks like he wanted to pitch it. Oh, my. He'll spin ahead across the 50 to the 49-yard line for a pickup of 2. But Griffin got that ball out there. Looked like he wanted to throw it up. And the clock approaching 1.5 minutes to go here. Farish, still on his feet, and he'll be brought down from behind. It looked like, I don't know, either Blakeman or Broward. We'll go with Broward. So Farish out to the 43-yard line. We're going to call it a pickup of 6 on the play. Excuse me, a pickup of 4 on the play. It'll be third down and short 4. Griffin rolling to his right. Indians will close. And they lose the football. They lose the football and the Indians have it. Griffin lost the football at the 33-yard line. And the Indians will have it.
Flag on the play against Woodland Hills. Penn Hills takes over on the football recovery. First down.
I fumbled so late. So there was a penalty on the play. The Indians will decline it, obviously. And they will have it with 32 seconds to go at their own 33-yard line. Well, the Indians look to try to go for something here. They have all three timeouts left. Oh, they play for the overtime. Darby wrapped up at the line of scrimmage.
Darby, the ball carrier.
Have no gain on the play. And the clock will continue to run. The Wolverines have one timeout left. I don't think they're going to use it. And I think the Indians are going to let the clock wind down and let's take this one to overtime. And that's exactly what we're going to do. And we will. That's it. After four quarters of play, we're scoreless. We're going to overtime. Penn Hills, Woodland Hills on the MSA Sports Network. Captains will meet at midfield to determine the possession here in the overtime. The rules are simple. Each team gets an opportunity from the 10-yard line. You got four plays, barring any penalties. First team up, you got to do something. You don't get in the end zone. Second team up, kicks a field goal, they win. You kick a field goal, second team up, scores a touchdown. Touchdown wins. You get up, score something. Second team doesn't, game over. So you got to match. If you have the ball second, you have to match or better your opponent to keep the overtime going. Now the interesting tidbit into this one is the Indians kicker Mike Dellaquila coming over from the soccer team. A lot of pressure going to be put on him there possibly. So I think the Indians won the toss, but are they bringing out the offense or the defense? I think you'd want to bring out the defense first. So nobody's really quite sure what's going on here. Overtime number one. This game will keep on going ad infinitum until there is a winner.
And now, fans, get out of your seats and onto your feet because it's Big Red time!
And it looks like the Indians will, in fact, go on defense first. So here we go. I think if you're the Wolverines, go Jezovic, Jezovic, Jezovic. And the Wolverines will go Farish, and Farish will be dropped for a loss of two. The ball's on the field, but he will be down. Joe Rash comes up to drop him for a loss of two. And it'll be second down for the Wolverines. Again, there is no clock. There is no first down marker. You start off first and goal. So now it's second down and goal, Wolverines. Griffin will throw. Looks. Throws towards the end zone. And the pass is almost intercepted. DJ Wilds breaks it up. Had he intercepted, the Indians would have gotten possession. But now it's third and goal from the 12.
DJ Wilds breaks up Griffin's pass. Third down.
Second line goes up. DJ Wilds. I think the last time we went to overtime here was a few years ago when Gateway came to town. as I recall. Wolverines send Twins to the right. Yezovich is in the slot. Ferris is the lone setback. Griffin will drop. Looks under pressure. I think they blew a whistle here. The play is dead. Delay of game against the Wolverines. So it'll march this one back to the 17-yard line. Actually, it could have been a break for the Wolverines. At least they'll keep the down. Ferris was under pressure. Looked like he was ready to be sacked close to the 20-yard line. So it'll be a 5-yard penalty. Instead of being fourth down for the Wolverines, it's now third down from the 17. And the Wolverines getting into some slop. And both teams will host the first round opponents Friday night. Wolverines at the Wolverina, the Indians here at Yuhas-McGinley, regardless of what happens here tonight. Griffin. Rolling, looking, throwing. Throws one to the end zone, and it's picked off by the Indians. So there's an interception in the end zone. The Wolverines do not get an opportunity on fourth down. The Indians take possession at the 10. Theoretically, they could bring out Delaquila and kick a field goal here, but I think you're going to want to try to get at least get inside the 5.
Punted the ball twice. Woodland Hills punted the ball twice in one possession.
Yeah, one play. He punted the ball. It got blocked.
And there's a timeout on the field. I think the Indians called the timeout to set things up. Let's just keep it. Kevin, we got time to keep it here? We're just going to keep it right on rolling. Oh, my. We're scoreless, but a game for the ages.
Oh, yeah.
I think we're going to credit the interception to Eric Taylor. And the Indians will talk it over. I think you're going to see Aaron Williams. Indians score in any fashion on this possession, the game is over. And now the Indian offense will come on. Big thing is a clean snap between Wiley and Fulton. They've had trouble with that tonight. And it looks like the Indians are bringing in the power eye. No, Joe Rash will go up to the line. No, they do bring in the power eye. Indians double tight, power eye. Fulton's going to throw as a man wide open in the end zone. Oh, my. Look at Joe Rash all by himself. Oh, Joe Rash. Oh, my. That was the game right there. Fulton didn't see him, and Rash was wide open. I mean, there was nobody. He was in the middle of the end zone. The closest guy was at the 5, a good 10 yards away. Aaron Williams hit in the backfield, stays on his feet, will drive ahead to the 10-yard line. No gain on the play for Aaron Williams. It'll be a third down and 10. So it's third down for the Indians. And the Indians go double tight, power eye. It's like some room to the right. Fulton again will throw. Throws to the end zone. And it's incomplete. Rash was covered this time. And the Indians, are they going to bring on Delaquila? Yes, they will. Delaquila will try a 27-yard field goal to end it. Indians will set up for a 27-yarder. Carlos Scott will hold. Kick is down. The kick is up. And the kick is good. The Indians win. Mike Delaquila, 27-yard field goal. And he's going to be the muddiest man on the field. Mike Delaquila is under the pile. And he's going to have to come up for some air sooner or later. Oh, my. The Indians win the conference. Mike Delaquila, probably the most unlikely man you would think would win the game for the Indians tonight, has come on to kick a 27-yard field goal here in the first overtime, and the Indians win 3-0. Oh, my, Mike Delaquila, who came over a few weeks ago from the soccer team, isn't, yeah, okay, yeah, why not, I'll come play. Filling in for Eric Mastriano, who tore a meniscus in his knee at Fox Chapel. He struggled, and he come on and he nailed the 27-yard field goal. Oh, Mr. Cool under pressure nails it. Holy cow. In a game with 8 fumbles, 2 interceptions. The weather obviously a factor in this game. In a game that really nobody deserved to walk away with the win or the loss. Mike Delaquila in overtime kicks the 27-yarder and the Indians will win the conference. Now it's just a matter, will they be seeded second? Will they be seeded third?
You have the stats. Was that his first field goal?
Holy mackerel. I think that was in fact Mike Delaquila's first field goal of the year. His first field goal attempt of the season. Nails it. And the Indians win. The Indians win. The Indians win. What else is there to say in a scoreless game? Really? How long of a wrap-up could we have here? Teams are scoreless. That breaks the Woodland Hills Wolverines scoreless streak at 21 quarters. They've not given up a point since September 22nd. And Delaquila comes on to end their winning streak. Both teams hosting games Friday night. Woodland Hills at the Wolverine, Penn Hills here at Yuhas-McGinley. As the Indians win the first ever Big East Conference championship, and they do it right here before the home folks, and oh my. You know what, we could wrap this up real quick, but look at these kids out there. They deserve this. Opening the season, and nobody gave them a chance. A lot of folks picked them to go 2-7. A lot of question marks, and the Indians win the conference. Oh my. And a name that will go down forever in Penn Hills lore, Mike Delaquila. Remember that one. And there they go, the Big East Conference champ, Penn Hills Indians. Your final score here from Yuhas-McGinley. In overtime, the Penn Hills Indians 3, the Woodland Hills Wolverines 0. We'll see you Friday night, round 1 of the WPIAL playoffs. And it'll be right here at Yuhas-McGinley. I'm Bill Navari. Thanks for watching Penn Hills Indians football here on the MSA Sports Network.